morning. Welcome to those of you who are here in Minneapolis, and also to those of you who are joining us from afar. It is my pleasure to speak with you this morning about my work looking at how inequality impacts cooperation in other species to understand how it does so in ourselves. So humans are intensely cooperative, but of course so are other species. What sets humans apart is the fact that we are able to cooperate outside of the local group, as exemplified by feats like the International Space Station. Well, how we do so is a matter for some discussion. Perhaps it's because we are able to join multiple groups at the same time. Perhaps it's because we are able to redefine what counts as the local group. But one thing that we share in common with other species is the fact that cooperation is impacted very strongly by one factor, and that is how we respond when outcomes are unfair. Humans care quite a lot about unfairness. Whether we are protesting because of an illegal occupation by a foreign power or occupying in the name of social justice, humans expend extreme amounts of time, energy, and money in the name of creating more egalitarian conditions. And whether it's something as large as our economies or our governments, or something as simple as a game of children's tag, if outcomes are unfair, cooperation will often collapse. But what stands out to me as a scientist who studies something other than humans is that in this, we are not alone. Other species also show responses to inequity. And what has driven my research for many years is understanding how other species respond to inequity and using this to understand how the inequity drives cooperation, how the two are related, and how this tells us something about the evolution of inequality and cooperation. But you have a question, I'm guessing, which is how on earth do you study something like fairness in another species? After all, this is a social ideal, and how can you study a social ideal in another species, particularly one that's nonverbal? Well, the answer is that you break it down into constituent components, ideally those that are actually experimentally tractable, and then you study each of these, and later put the results of this together into the larger picture to try and understand the greater whole. In the case of fairness, what we do is we started with the simplest possible question. How do individuals respond when they get less than a social partner for doing the same work? So to study this initially, we started with my capuchin monkeys. We took two capuchin monkeys from the same social group, seated them side by side, had them do a task, and then we rewarded them differently. Focusing on the three most important components, we had three simple conditions. First was an equity test, so two monkeys traded a token with me, and they got the same reward. In this case, it was a cucumber, which is something capuchins like quite a lot. Then we compared this outcome to how they responded to the inequity test. In this case, the subject continued to respond for the exchange for the cucumber, but the partner was exchanging for a grape. So we could compare how the subject responded to that cucumber when the partner got the grape, as compared to how they responded when the partner got that cucumber. So that way, if they're responding more when their partner gets the grape, we can say that they might have a response to inequity. Of course, you may be thinking there's actually one other difference here. In the inequity condition, we're repeatedly drawing their attention to that grape because we're repeatedly handing it to the partner. So maybe what we're actually seeing is a contrast effect because they're seeing that grape and so now they want it. So we also included a contrast control, what we called our equity plus grape condition. So in that case, we showed them the grape, waited until they gestured towards it, which suggested that they'd seen it, put it down, and then traded with them and gave them the cucumber. So everybody still gets a cucumber, like in the equity condition, but they are having their attention drawn to that grape every single time. So to give you an idea of what this looks like, I've got a video I'll show you in a second. We've got two females from the same social group here, and it's important to note that for all of our research, we draw monkeys and apes from the same social group. It's important that they have strong social relationships, and most of our individuals grew up in the social groups that they're currently living in. We're also in Georgia, which means that they can live outside in large outdoor enclosures most of the year, if not all of the year. And all of our testing is voluntary, which means that we never try to compel testing by depriving them of food, of treats, of water, of social access, outdoor access, or anything else. So they participate because they want to. So we think we're getting relatively natural responses to these sorts of interactions. So here you see two monkeys, two females. Lance is on your right, Winter is on your left. Lance is going to be trading for the cucumber, followed by Winter trading for the grape. So here you see Lance. She's trading for the cucumber. She gets it. You can see she's happily eating the cucumber. Winter is busy handing back grape skins because our well-fed capuchin monkeys don't like to eat the skins. But then she trades. She gets a grape. She happily eats it. Lance definitely sees this. So she happily trades and gets her cucumber. She's going to take a bite, and then she throws it right back at the experimenter. So clearly, she's not happy with this outcome. Meanwhile, Winter's continuing to go about her business. She trades and gets another grape. Lance is a little more upset this time, so she takes her time. She's going to bang the token for a few minutes, then she returns it. This time, she gets the cucumber, and she doesn't even take a bite before she throws it back out again at the experimenter. So Lance is our only capuchin monkey who has aimed overhand throwing. But as this anecdote shows, this is the sort of reaction that we got. So across multiple experiments with multiple different monkey groups, what we find is generally what you see in this data set. They are much more likely to refuse the cucumber when their partner gets a grape, as compared to when they both get cucumber, and compared to that contrast control when we show them a grape, but we give them a cucumber. And this suggests that the monkeys are much more upset by inequity than they are by contrast. We are also interested in what are some of the conditions that may affect their inequity responses. So for instance, in humans, people have looked quite a lot at what the value of the rewards may be doing. Actually, the ultimatum game results suggest that humans are actually pretty sensitive to fairness, even for very large sums of money. But that doesn't seem to be the case with the capuchins. We repeated this study using a low-value reward, a medium-value reward, and a high-value reward, and found that they would refuse the low-value reward if their partners got a medium or high-value reward, but they wouldn't refuse the medium-value reward if their partner got a high-value reward, which is the blue line, no matter what the high-value reward was. So this suggests that they're willing to refuse when they're getting something that they don't love, but they're not willing to refuse something that is too good. We've also gotten interested in understanding individual differences in responses, which you certainly see in humans. And in capuchins, we haven't found much evidence of these, but we do see that in chimpanzees. For instance, we see a dominance effect in chimpanzees. So more dominant chimpanzees are more likely to respond to inequity than more subordinate ones, which makes sense. After all, more dominant individuals are used to getting the better outcomes. They're also used to getting what they want. So you might expect them to be more responsive to inequity than more subordinate ones. We're also particularly interested in relationship quality. So in humans, relationship quality does influence inequity responses. So humans in closer relationships tend to be less responsive to inequity than those who are in more distant ones. And some of our early chimpanzee data suggest the same things. We have a 2005 study in chimpanzees that shows that chimpanzees from a long-term group with very close relationships were less likely to respond to inequity than those from a group that had been put together very recently and had less close relationships. But to test this more carefully, we decided to test chimpanzees in four different social groups where we tested, where possible, every chimp with every other chimpanzee in their social group. And so we brought them in sequentially to see what they would do. We did find a relationship effect. But remember, all of our testing is voluntary, and what we found was relationship quality affected who was willing to come in and test together. So only slightly more than half of our subjects were willing to consistently come in and test together, and those were the ones with the strongest relationships, as measured by how frequently they groomed in other contexts. So we still don't have a measure of relationship quality and how it influences inequity, but we did find that there was actually a personality effect in this study, wherein more social chimpanzees, so those who are spending more time with other chimps, grooming and so forth, were also more likely to respond to inequity. However, getting back to the original question, if these guys are responding to inequity, we're interested in how this relates to cooperation. So there's a long-standing hypothesis in both economics and psychology that actually inequity is a partner choice mechanism. So essentially, if you're working with another individual and they're constantly getting better rewards than you, that tells you something about them as a social partner. It's pretty much time to go find a new one. Because even if you go sample the environment at random, if you're getting treated sufficiently badly in this cooperative interaction, you'll probably do better if you go try with somebody else. So if that is the case, if inequity is a partner choice mechanism for cooperation, there are two predictions that we have that follow from that. First is that we should expect to see a phylogenetic effect. More cooperative species, you might expect to see are more likely to respond to inequity. And secondly, within cooperative interactions, you should expect to see inequity to impact cooperation. So looking at the first of these, we've now tested inequity across 10 different primate species and other species as well, although I don't have time to talk about them. And within that, we do see the predicted correlation. So species that are typically highly cooperative with non-kin, whose names are highlighted in yellow, are also the ones that tend to respond in these inequity tests. Their pictures are highlighted with the yellow square. There are a couple of interesting things to note. First of all, the cooperative breeders. So these are the ones where males and females have biparental care of offspring. The calotrichids and the owl monkeys, whose names are highlighted in pink, do not show an inequity response, which was actually a surprise and counter to our prediction, because after all, cooperative breeding is intensely cooperative. But we got to thinking about it, and most of the individuals who were tested were mated pairs, and often they had offspring. So in that case, they're actually quite interdependent. So if inequity is a partner choice mechanism, maybe it's not worth giving up that particular interdependent relationship over a cucumber versus a grape. So our new hypothesis is that we should be looking at these partnerships during pair bond formation and seeing whether they're particularly sensitive to inequity at that point. I also highlighted humans in pink because, of course, humans also have cooperative breeding. But most of the studies in humans are done on individuals who may even be strangers. So it would be really interesting to get more into detail on how humans who are involved in cooperative child rearing are doing. The other interesting thing is that most of this is focused at the species level, but of course there's a lot of variability within species. So one species, squirrel monkeys or cimeri, is particularly variable. And we looked at one particular demographic, female Bolivian squirrel monkeys, who happened to be particularly cooperative, and actually just had a paper accepted showing that they also happened to show a slightly stronger response to inequity than other squirrel monkeys, suggesting that we also need to be looking with a little more nuance than just at the species level, and considering how different ecological and social factors may be influencing this evolutionary relationship. Considering the second point, we're interested in how inequality influences cooperation. So to do this, I'm going to focus on capuchin monkeys, who are highly cooperative and very easy to study in the lab for cooperation. We use what's called the barpole task, which is simply a counterweighted tray that requires two monkeys to pull it in. They pull it in on their barpole, and when they do, they can reach out and grab the food in front of them. In a mutualism task where both of them are working for the same foods, they are extremely successful. However, it's also really easy to introduce inequality and see how that impacts their outcomes. So the first of these tasks was done by Franz DeWall and Jason Davis, and they compared the monkeys' responses on the typical standard version of the task where the monkeys pull in the tray and grab the food to a clumped version in which the foods were still separated into individual cups, but the two cups were clumped in the middle of the tray. So the monkeys had to pull in the tray and then move to the middle and grab the food. Well, of course, what that means is that the food rewards are monopolizable. So one individual can go in and grab all the food rewards. And the prediction was that this should impact cooperation because they're going to learn that one individual can grab the food rewards. And indeed, it did. From the very first trial, the monkeys were much less successful and cooperation tailed off over time. And so this suggests that these monkeys, who again are from the same social group and have long-standing relationships, were able to extrapolate from their normal day-to-day lives to this novel situation and realize that this was not probably a great situation in which to be cooperating, and so they failed to do so in the clumped condition, but kept right on cooperating in the standard condition. We did something similar where we used the standard condition where the monkeys can pull in and grab their food, but in this case we varied the food rewards. So either the monkeys were pulling in for two pieces of apple, two grapes, or one apple and one grape. And in this case, the monkeys had to decide for themselves who was pulling on which side. So our prediction was that they would struggle the most in the unequal apple-grape condition, because now they have to decide who's getting the apple and who's getting the grape. That wasn't the case, actually. They pulled equally well across all of the conditions. But what we did find was that there was a difference among the partnerships. Some of them were what we called equitable partnerships and some inequitable partnerships. In the equitable partnerships, which you see here in green, the dominant and the subordinate both got the grape in that unequal apple grape condition about half the time. But in the inequitable partnerships, here in pink, the dominant got the grape the majority of the time in the unequal apple grape condition. And if you look at how they did across in cooperation based on these partnerships, the equitable partnerships were extremely successful across all three conditions, whereas the inequitable partnerships weren't. And in fact, the equitable partnerships did just fine in the unequal condition, suggesting that a little transient inequality is fine as long as things even out over the long term. And the inequitable partnerships weren't successful in any condition, suggesting that those monkeys weren't simply saying, hey, I'm willing to cooperate as long as you can't take more than me, and so they were doing fine in the grape, grape, or apple, apple condition when their partners couldn't get more than them, but they were just refusing to cooperate with their partner in any context, which again suggests a partner choice mechanism. They were responding against the partner and not to the distribution per se. Of course, responding negatively to getting less than a partner isn't all there is to fairness. We would also expect that if you're a fair individual, you are responding when you get more than someone else as well. So we can test this fairly simply using our inequity paradigm by including an equity high value condition in which both individuals trade and get the grape. Using the same logic, we can look at the partner's response to the grape when the subject also gets a grape compared to the partner's response to the grape when the subject gets a cucumber. To make a long story short, in most species, you don't see any response whatsoever. They keep happily eating their grapes. But in chimpanzees, we see the chimpanzees refusing the grape about twice as often when their partner gets a cucumber as compared to when their partner gets a grape, suggesting that they do notice when they get more than their partner. What we don't see is we don't see any attempts to rectify, so we're not seeing sharing of the grape. And I will point out that they are also far, far more likely to refuse when they get less than a partner than they are when they get more than a partner. But in this, they also look a lot like humans. So this is a really nice data set I pulled from Peter Blake and Katie McAuliffe's 2015 Nature paper. And this is kids from 7 different societies ranging from age 4 to 15 who refuse quite a lot when they are disadvantaged compared to a social partner, but don't refuse very much at all when they are advantaged compared to a social partner. In fact, only kids from 3 societies do so, and they do so at a lesser rate than they did for the disadvantageous condition, suggesting that humans and chimpanzees are fairly similar in this. So, what does this mean for the evolution of fairness and how it ties into cooperation? I think that this is best considered by breaking fairness down into 2 distinct components. So the first is what I would call first-order fairness. So individual A gets a great reward, individual B continues to get less valuable reward. This happens repeatedly. Eventually, individual B is going to get irritated and walk off and go find a new partner. This is fairness as a partner choice mechanism, and it is very effective at that. As a matter of fact, I would predict that we will find this robustly across the animal kingdom, not just in mammals, not just in vertebrates, but probably quite a bit more widespread than that in any species that routinely cooperates, because it is such an effective mechanism to help make sure individuals aren't taken advantage of by their cooperative partners. However, while this is really effective for finding the best cooperative partner, it is not effective for maintaining cooperation or for causing cooperation to grow and prosper. For that, you need what I would call second-order fairness. So second-order fairness starts in the same way. One individual is getting more than the other individual, but in this case, if the second individual is protesting, if the individual A, who's getting more, plays their cards right, they can forestall individual B's protest. They can do something to equalize the outcomes, and if they do it properly, individual B's protest is going to disappear, and cooperation will be maintained. So in this way, individual A pays a short-term cost that maintains the long-term benefit of this cooperative interaction, and they have a mechanism via which they can not only maintain, but again, cause this cooperative relationship to prosper and grow. So there's some evidence that we might see this in chimpanzees, and I wouldn't be surprised if we see it in a few other intelligent, long-lived species that also cooperate. But of course, it's humans with our advanced cognitive abilities that allow us to plan years into the future, to understand consequences, to have the theory of mind to understand how our actions are impacting those around us, that can really take this to the next level and take advantage of this. So it is this, I think, this ability at fairness, that is what has allowed us to create these really truly impressive cooperative systems that can withstand the inevitable inequalities that emerge in day-to-day life. Thank you.